like you to repeat after me.
We'll pretend we're on a liturgical church this morning. Father, what I'm carrying
isn't easy,
and it isn't light. How true is that? No. It's a little slow. If you say, Father, what I'm carrying today is not easy and it's not light. You ever do that? You're so burdened, you're so stressed, you're so stretched, that you go, is this really God's will? Is it God's will for me to be pushed to the brink? Is it God's will for me to barely make it through each day? Is it God's will for me to feel like, man, I don't know if I can hang on much longer? That certainly is not God's will. Look at Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. Jesus says, come to me. Come to me. All you are weary and burdened, that fit anybody? And I will give you rest. Can you just imagine it? Rest. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. That doesn't sound very restful, does it? Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Do you ever struggle to believe that? My yoke is easy and my burden is light. When I read that, I thought, Lord, I believe your word, but man, this has challenged me, because sometimes the yoke that I've got on me and the burden I've got on me does not feel easy and light. Can I get a witness? Sometimes it feels pretty tough. So I would like for us to look at what Jesus said here. And this may be, I am always looking at holidays with an eye toward creativity. I can tell you, for me, and I think I speak for most pastors, that the toughest sermons all year to preach are the sermons that you're expected to preach certain things. Like, how do you find a new twist on the nativity scene? How do you find a new age? So I think this is really at the heart of the Christmas message, that Jesus came to become relevant to our life, because life in a fallen world is just too difficult. There's too much on us. So Jesus came, that's Christmas, to intervene in a very difficult life and make it where we could rest while he does the heavy lifting. Amen? And that's what we really celebrate. Let's get started. He said, come to me. Come to me. Come to me. All you're weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Come to me, and I will give you rest. The first key is what we call an imperative. Come to the Lord. Now, this has nothing to do with where you are geographically. When he said, come to me, I don't think he meant move from that chair to this seat, though some of you could. Because you know the best seats in church are the front ones. They're brand new. They've almost not been sit in. Especially these that we call in the spit section. How many know what the spit section is? We spray this area right here, you know. But we could say, come forward, but I don't think it had anything to do with geography. Jesus said it this way in another passage a few chapters later. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In other words, he said, these people are saying all the right things, and they're singing all the right songs, but their hearts are not near me. How many know that it's possible to do this church thing all day long, every day, and not really be close to Jesus? And it's very difficult when you're trying to do your Christianity and not be close to Jesus, where he can put his shoulder in and lift the weight off of your shoulders. Now let's talk about how do we come to him. Now, Jesus just said, come to me, and so we're left kind of thinking, okay, what does that mean? So I would like to fill in that blank. So this is my theory. But I will use, I didn't give you time, did I? My theory. But so I'll fill in. What does it mean to come to him? This is what I think that we have to do to really come to him, not geographically, but spiritually. First of all, I think you have to leave your plans and accept his. Leave your plans and accept his. Watch this. Everybody loves Jeremiah 29:11, don't they? You see it everywhere. Everybody's talking about it. But watch this. Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you. Now, Notice what he doesn't say. He doesn't say, I know your plans. I know the plans you have for you, and I'm going to bless those plans if you pray enough. He says, I know the plans I have for you. I mean, you're getting this. I can't just come back and finish this next week. I got to preach another sermon on the wise men next week because you expect a Christmas sermon. So let's get with it, folks. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. He says, come on. I have plans for your life, plans that will prosper you and not harm you, plans that will do good things for you. So go ahead and give up your plans and take up my plans because those plans are going to work. I think I offended a guy last week. I didn't mean to, but we were having communication online and it stopped. And all I did, why do you assume the worst? Me. He was sending me emails, and I didn't know the guy, but he was sending me emails, wanted me to agree with him in prayer, and he kept saying, I have begged God for this. I have prayed for this. I've pleaded with God for this. I've fasted. And I just simply wrote back and said, maybe you should quit asking God to bless what you're asking Him to bless and do what He's going to bless. Does that make any sense at all? Maybe God's plans are not your plans. Hello? Maybe God doesn't want for you what you think you want for yourself. And so I'm saying, God, please. You know that great theologian, Garth Brooks? Anybody? You know him? He wrote a song some years ago. You know what I'm going to talk about? I thank God for unanswered prayer. You know? He talked about when he was young, he used to pray that God would allow him to marry this one lady. And years later, he marries the lady he's supposed to. And he meets this other lady. He looks and says, thank God you didn't answer that prayer. Sometimes we don't know what's best for us. And I think that's why we have to go to God and say, God, what plans do you have for my life? And I am giving up my plans and taking your plans. And I suspect that a lot of times we wear ourselves out trying to get God to bless what we want done. When God is simply saying, that's not my plan. That's not what I want for you. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Now let me put my plans. So are you willing today to come to the Lord, gather up all of your plans, all of your ideas, all your creativity, lay it down and say, God, will you sort through this? And anything that doesn't match up with your plan for my life, please throw it away. Amen? Just get rid of it. Do away with your plans and take God's plans. Often God, I don't want to say this. I don't want to make it seem like God is somehow limited. But sometimes we limit God by asking Him to do things when He's asking us just to give up. Just give up and come on. You know? You ever worked for a boss that wasn't as smart as you? If any of my staff says anything, I'm going to hit you. You wear yourself out trying to educate that boss, trying to get them to understand what they need to do. And then one day you have a realization the best thing you can do is just execute the boss's plan and life gets a whole lot easier. Maybe that's what's happening in our relationship with the Lord. Abandon your plans and take His. Secondly, experience a transformation in your desires. Experience a transformation in your desires. Matthew chapter 6, verse 21, this time he says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Now, I believe that the eye symbolizes, you've heard me say this before, the eye symbolizes desire. when he says the eye is the light of the body. If the eye is dark, the whole body will be full of dark. I think what he's saying, if what you want is dark, everything about your life eventually is going to become dark. And if your eye is good and whole and healthy, then everything about your life is going to be good and whole and healthy. So here's a theory. You will never consistently behave in a way that is opposite of your desire. You will never consistently behave in a way that is opposite of your desires. Your desires will eventually always win because they're there all the time. I don't know how many times I have said, I am never having another Hostess cupcake. How many times I've said, I'm never going to buy the supersized peanut M&M's? Never. And then I have a dream about sitting in a bathtub full of peanut M&M's. Don't judge me. Not everyone can rock the chubby look the way I can. But friends, until we do something about what we want, we will never change. Change, lasting change, takes place at the desire level. Until then, we're just fighting with ourselves. And eventually, desire will always win. So if I really want to stop doing something, if I want to stop falling for that temptation, I have to deal with it at the level of desire. I have to say, God, transform my desire. Change what I want so that when that temptation comes, I don't even want it. At this level, my whole body will be full of light because God has changed my desire. Your desires will eventually win out. So we have to go to God and say, God, change what I want. Help me see with your eyes. Help me imagine with your eyes. Help me think with your mind so that I want what you want. Number three, trade your strength for His. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Literally, when he says renew, he means exchange. To trade. When I go to Him, I trade my weakness for His strength. I go and I say, Lord, this willpower that I'm trying to use to win the battles of life is just not going to get it done. Will you give me your strength? They that wait upon the Lord, they that hope upon the Lord, those who put their trust in the Lord, they will renew. They will trade their strength for His strength, and then different things start happening. The old patterns are broken, and we begin to do things differently than we've ever done them before. Amen? We trade our strength for His strength. You know what? I never forget to pray when I'm desperate. How about you? I'm going through a really difficult time. I'm going through a really dangerous time. I never have any trouble falling on my face before God. And if we think about it, we are always desperately dependent upon the strength of God. Amen? And when we put that before us and say, this is what I have to do, I cannot be a prayerless Christian because a prayerless Christian is a weak Christian. I don't have the power that I need to do what it is that I need to do. All right? Secondly, he said, take my yoke upon you. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. Take my yoke upon you. It's an imperative. What is a yoke? I'm not talking about what that yellow thing inside egg, you know. Yoke. It is a way that you attach an animal to some type of implement. You yoke an oxen to a plow so it can pull. You yoke animals to wagons so they can move. It's that thing that locks you down. It is a symbol of work. I would have used a symbol of work to talk about rest. But my yoke is easy. My burden is light. I think he is talking about expectations. God wants us to take some expectations on our life. And before I talk to you about God's expectations, can I talk to you about some of the yokes that you're probably struggling with right now? The things when the yoke is heavy and difficult, I just made a list of them. I think, first of all, there is the yoke of unreasonable expectations. Have you ever had someone slip this one on you? Right there on your chest, there's a big S. Because you're Superman, you're Superwoman. You stretch to the limits. Because you've got to do above and beyond anything other people could possibly do. You've got to be the rescuer. You've got to be there for everyone. You've got to somehow fix everything that's broken. You are Superman, you're Superwoman, and you're wearing the yoke of unreasonable expectation. In fact, some people are even using you as a substitute for God. And this yoke is oppressive. Because you might make a pretty good Christian, but you make a terrible God. Amen? I remember when we first started out in ministry, I had this idea that the man of God had to have all the answers. And then I remember I was listening to someone ask my opinion on something, and it was a very complex, complicated something, and it's like the Holy Spirit nudged me and said, here's the answer to what when they get done. I'm ready for this word of knowledge, word of wisdom. And it's like the Holy Spirit said, tell them you don't know. Well, that doesn't sound very anointed. Tell them you don't know. You're wearing the yoke of unreasonable expectations, and it's killing you. It's taking all the fun out of being my child because you think you've got to answer every question and know everything and rescue everyone. Tell them you don't know. Tell them to point them to me. Because you don't make a very good God. Is this landing anywhere else? Come on. You're trying to fix everybody else's life, and your life is very, very difficult because right here it is, the yoke of unreasonable expectations. I was splitting wood one time with a friend of mine, and we needed to change some setting on the splitter. And it's very heavy, very heavy. And this guy was bigger than me, so he was trying to pick it up and slide the pin in, and he couldn't do it. Finally, I got frustrated. I said, here, you stick the pin in. I run around to the back side of this splitter, and I pick this thing up, and I lift it up. He sticks it in there, and then I stay in bed for 2 weeks. Something in my back just went, it was way too heavy for me. But I'm Hercules. Hercules. I'm going to do it. You know. I know I've got a lot of cover. I can't stop very long here. But I really feel like the Holy Spirit's saying something to some people here right at this moment. Your life's never going to be any fun until you admit you can't do it all. Unbuckle that yoke of unreasonable expectations and set it down. And it's okay to look at someone and say, I don't have the answer. Or, I wish I could help, but I can't right now. I have limitations. I'll just leave that with you since you're enjoying it so much. The yoke of a worldly definition of success. Worldly definition of success is when we define success with numbers. We define success with numbers. We got to have a certain number of dollars, a certain number of people, a certain number. And the problem with this is that no one can agree on what the number is. Because no matter how many numbers you rack up, somebody else is racking up better numbers. And so it's kind of like that old country and western song, which I'm too spiritual to listen to. My friends tell me about it. Every time I make my mark, somebody paints the wall. Isn't that not funny? At least Dan thinks so. No one. There's always a worldly definition of success is just, you know, when you get in that house that you've always wanted, there will be another neighborhood that's even better. And those people will be looking down their nose at you. So you got to try harder and harder and harder so you can get in that neighborhood. And then you probably don't have the best house in that neighborhood, so you got to move it on up, like the Jeffersons, you know. You got to keep on, keep on, keep on, and before you know it, you are chasing your tail like a dog, and you're not getting anywhere because you're trying to define success for your life based on some number that no one seems to know what that number is. Even people with massive numbers attached to their accomplishments still are depressed and drug addicted and suicide. What is it telling us? That worldly definition of success is a grievous burden to try and carry. There is the yoke of solitary service. Loneliness is hard. You were brought into the fellowship of God, not the solitude of God. You were made to be a part of the body. Down deep inside, there's something that says to you, you are part of a body. You're part of a living spiritual organism that you're supposed to be a hand, a foot, an eye, an ear. You're not supposed to be the whole thing. Try to minister without the body and you'll find yourself lonely and discouraged and weak and incomplete and insufficient, all those things. Number four, there is the yoke of disobedience. The Bible says the way of the unfaithful is hard. Sometimes people think that being a Christian is hard, but the Bible says the way of the unfaithful is hard, difficult. You've seen them, haven't you? You've seen people who, perhaps people you love, you care about, who are systematically destroying their happiness by bad decisions. By deciding to be disobedient to the standards of Scripture, they just keep on digging themselves deeper and deeper into a hole of unhappiness because they just keep making the same mistakes, the same bad decisions. The way of the transgressor is hard. You ever hang out with persons? Every once in a while, you have a privilege of leading a group of men on a mission trip. We spend anywhere from a week to 3 weeks somewhere. You know what we at times find out in those? Who snores? And I don't. If you heard that I do, it's a lie from the pit. Chris, shut up. But when we all would bunk down at night, and some of the guys would almost minutes ahead hit the pillow and you'd hear the snoring start. And I always thought that's the sound of a clear conscience. That's the sound of a clear conscience. So if your spouse snores, don't worry about it. Just kidding. But don't you like laying down at night and having peace in your spirit, that there's no hidden secrets, there's no anticipation of judgment coming your way, just knowing me and the Lord are good. You know, we're good. We're at peace with one another. The yoke that Jesus offers. First, it's the yoke of reasonable expectations. Notice he says in Matthew 25:21, his master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. Few things. I will put you in charge of many. Come and share your master's what? Happiness." When I focus on doing what God has gifted me to do, what He's called me to do, are you listening? Life is much easier. In fact, are we making good enough time? Your stomach growling? I had to go through a process in life, and every once in a while I have to go back and re-go through it again because we sometimes fall back. But I remember at times, and I think I'm revisiting that thing that was so rough on some of you a few minutes ago, unreasonable expectations and now reasonable expectations. I remember at times in my life as a pastor being pushed to the limit of bases I could pass. And then one day I realized, and some of you are going to need to realize this, that every week for the rest of my life as a pastor, when I go home Friday evening, I will have disappointment. And I have to make peace with that. There will be some bases I will not have had a chance to pass. There will be some assignments given to me that I will not have been able to complete. And I've got to look at those things and go, I'm going to be okay with this. If I can't do everything that's expected of me, that's okay. Those of you who are people pleasers, you're really struggling right now. We need to sing "Just As I Am" and you need to come get saved. You know? It's okay. When the apostles were under the yoke of unreasonable expectation in the book of Acts, Peter said, we're going to give ourselves to prayer and to the Word of God. That's going to be our priority. And if we don't get anything else done, we're going to do that. And friend, you know, I remember one time I was in one of my classes in Bible college. I was the designated whiner. Did you have a designated whiner? The one who whined about the homework assignments, whined about how hard the test was. Anybody? No? Well, we were pastoring, and we were driving about 3.5-4 hours down to the church group and coming back on Sunday night and all that. And so I would whine, and the students would all say, Jeff, talk to the professor out of homework this week. Tell him how tough your life is, you know, because... You know, and so I kind of got an inroad so I could say, hey, I got all this going on. Come on, professor, don't do this over the weekend. I won't have time. And I remember one time he stopped me and he said, Jeff, listen, there is enough time in every day to do God's will for that day. And if it's not God's will for you to get this assignment done, I'm okay with that. Are you okay with a lower grade? There's enough time in every day to do God's will for that day. Everything else is optional. Do as much as you feel comfortable in doing, but it's optional. The yoke of reason. Notice he said, well done, not much done. Well done, good and faithful servant. Not much done, well, good and faithful servant. Number two, it's the yoke of a biblical definition of success. A biblical definition of success. If the world looks my way and says, that guy's not very successful, that can't bother me. I can't let that get under my skin. I can't let it affect my identity. But if God looks at me and says, that guy's not very successful, that's got to be an alarm for me. So what would it take for God to look at me and say, that guy, that child of mine is successful? I'm glad you asked. Success is about faithfulness. Well done, good, and faithful servant. Faithful, sir. Well done, good and faithful. So if I am being faithful to God, and then he says, this is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. So here it is. When God looks at me and decides, and when God looks at you and says, is this person successful or not? It comes back to these two issues. Are you faithful and are you fruitful? Are you faithful and fruitful? Are you faithful to God and are you fruitful in your walk with God? And that defines success in the mind of God for every one of us. Thirdly, it's the yoke of body ministry. We replace solitary service with unified ministry. And you experience the fulfillment of being part of a body. Have you ever noticed that God put the church together? He could have sort of flung us all out there and said, hey, all you guys do something great for me, but he brought us together in a body, and he gave gifts to the body, and he gave ministries to the body, because the body is how it's happening. The church is God's plan, A, B, C, all the way to Z. There's no backup plan. The church is God's plan for reaching a lost world. And we're supposed to all be a part of that ministering body. And then it's the yoke of obedience. The Bible says this is love for God, to obey His commands, and His commands are not burdensome. Not burdensome. They're not difficult to walk in obedience. I believe the most miserable people in the world are Christians who are trying to be disobedient. Don't you? Christians who are trying to walk in disobedience are just miserable. But when we're walking in obedience, life is good. The fellowship with God is good. And that doesn't happen because someone handed me a list of rules and said, do all these things and God will be happy with you. It happens in a context of a relationship of love. And in that relationship of love, I do the things of God out of love for Him, not out of some religious obligation to Him. Did that make any sense? Let me illustrate it. Suppose that you or me or someone else go home at night and we look at our spouse and we say, let's celebrate. I was faithful to you today. Let's celebrate, babe. I was faithful to you. I didn't cheat on you not one time today. Hey, high five. How do you think that would go? My wife is not good. Because there is an expectation in that relationship that faithfulness will not be a struggle. Hello? Faithfulness will not be a struggle. You, me, our wives, our husbands, we expect that when our spouses are walking through this life that they're so in love for us. If anybody tries any hanky-panky, they hit them in the head with a rock. Maybe not a rock, but they're not even tempted, right? They just, oh no, see this ring? It means this may be eye candy. But it's not available. So just keep moving on, ladies. Nothing to see here. Nothing to see here. Keep moving on. All right, that's enough of that. The last thing I would ever want to do in the world is be unfaithful to my wife. Because of what it would do to her heart. Because of what it would do to my relationship with her. I'm not going to struggle moment by moment. Oh, I hope I'm not. I'm going to walk through this life with a heart, with a mind, with a body that's in a covenant, loving covenant relationship with my wife, and that's going to produce faithfulness. Amen. That's going to produce, and that's the kind of relationship the Lord has with us. That we don't go, I wish I could go get drunk and really, I don't want to do the stuff that hurts the heart of my Lord. I don't want to do something that would drive me away from Him. I want to walk in a manner that is pleasing to Him. Amen? His commandments are not burdensome. They are relational. They are loving. And then finally He said, learn from me. Learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you'll find rest for your soul. Jesus may be the first and only person in the history of the world to equate learning with resting. I'm going to go to algebra class and rest for a while. We don't do that, do we? We equate learning with hard work. It's difficult. We've got to press in. But Jesus said, learn of me, and you will find rest for your soul. The first lesson that we learn from Him is that He is gentle and humble in heart. It's another way of saying that we can approach Him and He's not furious and offended and waiting to judge us. We don't approach Him as an offended God. We come to Him as a loving Father who embraces us in our imperfection. He embraces us. We have access to Him. That's the concept we have from Him when we learn of Him. The second lesson is that our spirit is refreshed by learning from Him and about Him. When we learn from Him, there is an experience in His presence that's renews us and elevates us and refreshes us. When we learn about Him, our spirits are fed from the bread of life and we're strengthened and uplifted. Many people are, stay with me, many people are tired, so tired. Many people stayed home from church today to rest at the Chiefs game. Or they say, I don't know how many people I've talked to, said, oh, Sunday is the day I get to sleep in. And I think, you really want to rest, learn of Him. Learn of Him. And as we separate from the learning process, our soul becomes, listen, more and more fatigued. More and more weary. We've watched them. People who sit down in spiritual exhaustion and stay in a place God only wanted them to pass through. They stay in a desert that they were supposed to cross. Stay in a valley. They stay too long. One of my most memorable trips we had a few years ago when some of us went down to Nicaragua and put up what they call a church. In America, you might call it a carport. But we put up, and I remember one day the missionary had put us all on these little canoes, and we were crossing a river. A swamp area, and I was a little bit nervous. It was a tropical swamp area, and I looked over at the missionary, and I said, some of the guys were dangling their hands in the water, and I thought, I'm going to bring them back to their wives, missing limbs and digits, and I said, is it okay if you touch or should we worry about alligators and crocodiles? And the missionary laughed and said, don't worry about anything. There's nothing in this water. I said, this paradise? He said, no. They have killed every crocodile and eaten it. They have caught every fish and eaten it. If you look around, there's not even any animals in the trees. These people have eaten everything in this jungle. And I thought about that. Sometimes, we sit down at a spiritual place and we eat everything there and we desperately need to move on. We need to move on to a spiritual higher place in our life. And we need to move on to a place where there's food. We move on to a place where there is refreshing. And yet we've stopped right there. Maybe it was some loss. Maybe it was some sin. Maybe it's some desert event that just stopped us right there, and our spiritual life stopped right there, and we sat there, and basically we've devoured everything within reach. There's no resources left for us. So, friends, we've got to move along in our spiritual life. We cannot afford to stay where we've always been. The Bible says in Galatians 6:9, let us not grow weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we do not. Come unto me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me. I am meek and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. Wasn't the name of my sermon today? Take it easy. Take it easy. You and I were not designed to carry the weight of the world. And you probably are today. You've taken on so much. Listen, you're just wore out. You're tired. The Lord is looking right in your direction today, and He's saying, come to me. Come to me. I will give you rest. Quit trying to do my job for me. I will give you rest. Goodbye.